So the past two Sundays, we are in the book of Judges and weak people but strong God. And for the past two Sundays, we have talked about Gideon and you know how God used a weak vessel to deliver the Israel from the hands of the Midianites. Last Sunday, we actually learned about who's our topic last Sunday. He is Samson, okay? And we learned that from Samson, he is the one, on the other hand, was too strong that led the people, that led his downfall. But God still used him to deliver the Israelites from the Philistines. So Gideon, God delivered them from Midianites, and now Samson, God delivered them from the Philistine, all right? Okay, and again, the story of the nation of Israel shows a very sad cycle of sin. What is the sad cycle of sin for the Israelites? Disobedience, oppression, repentance. God will deliver them, then there will be peace in the land, and then they're going to commit sin again. That is the cycle of the sin of Israel, all right? After God saved them, God delivered them, after there's peace in the land, they will go back to their sins again, all right? It is in Judges that we see that this nation needs a Messiah, a godly king, because there is no good king to rule over them. Judges 17:6 says, in those days Israel had no king, all the people do whatever seemed right in their own eyes. That is very scary. Whatever is right in your own eye, just do it. You know? If it's right for you to worship another god, do it. That's what's happening in the land of Israel. If it's okay to marry the same cousin or the mother or the whatever, do it. That's how cruel the Israelites or evil their hearts were, okay? But we also know that God gave Israel a good king after many years, who is King David, all right? And after King David, we also know that the one true eternal king came to deliver the world from sin and made us royal priesthood and a holy nation, no other than our Lord Jesus Christ, okay? So Israel had no righteousness at all. They were looking for a godly king. Eventually, God gave them a godly king through King David and, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ. But it was a very long time, a very long process. So as we learn from some judges in the life of Israel, let us remember, so why do we need to actually take a look of the judges, you know, and learn from this? And why did God allow a very dark portion of Israel to be included in the Bible? We can actually have a clue. 1 Corinthians 10:11 to 12 says, these things happen so that we can be warned. They were written down to warn us who live at the end of the age. So if you think you are standing strong, be careful to not fall. What is this? It's a warning. Warning for all the Christians, all right? So as we learn from some judges in the life of Israel, let us remember, finish strong in the Lord. Everybody, let's focus and say, finish strong in the Lord. One more time. Finish strong in the Lord. Four words. We have many battles on earth against the devil, our flesh, and may we be overcomers who will join together and rally with Jesus, our victorious King. And I pray that all of us will be part of this great assembly. Amen? So today, we will look at the life of the fourth judge, who happens to be the only woman among the judges. She comes after Ehud, who in Judges chapter 3 led the Israelites to destroy the Moabites, and for 80 years there was peace in the land. But again, in the first four verses of Judges, we see once again the sin cycle of Israel. So if you open your Bibles, Judges 4, 1 to 4 says, after Ehud's death, the Israelites again did evil in the Lord's sight. So the Lord turned them over to King Jabin of Hazor, a Canaanite king. The commander of his army Sisera, who lived in Harosh Hagoyim. Sisera, who had 900 iron chariots, ruthlessly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. Then the people of Israel, what did they do? Cried out to the Lord for help. Deborah, the wife of Lapidoth, was a prophet who was judging Israel at that time. Take note of the underlying words, and those are our points for this afternoon. Number one point is that the Israelites again did evil in the Lord's sight. They did evil again, all right? After 80 years of peace, after Ehud, peace and goodness and everything, they did another cycle of sin. And then the Canaanites again oppressed Israel until they cried out again to God. They did evil again in the sight of God. My friends, on our own, in our own way, we will naturally go away from God. On our own, we will naturally go away from God. What did Apostle Paul said in Romans 3:10-18? As the scripture says, no one is righteous, not even one. No one is truly wise. No one is seeking God. All have turned away. All have become useless. No one does good, not a single one. Imagine that everyone is sinful. Their talk is foul like the stench from an open grave. Their tongues are filled with lies. Snake venom drips from their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. They rush to commit murder. Destruction and misery always follow them. They don't know where to find peace. They have no fear at God at all. Can you actually imagine this verse, Romans 3:10-18? This is a terrifying verse. There is no fear of God at all. And that is very, very dangerous. If you don't fear God anymore, my friends, you are going to go to destruction. If the protection of God is not on you anymore, I'm very sorry. The blessing of God is not on you anymore. That's very scary. Jeremiah 7 verse 9 says, the human heart is most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? The context of this verse covers the warning not to trust man or yourself, which can be the source of idolatry. Don't trust man or yourself. The heart does not seek the Lord anymore. That is why our hearts can be deceitful of all things. This is the reason why we need our hearts to be changed by the Holy Spirit. We need a born-again experience. And while our status is changed and we become children of God, our transformation or sanctification is a process and often a struggle. And we will see this more as we go on. It's not a one-click thing. If you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're changed. Then it's not a magic, okay? You will still go through a lot of struggles until you become mature. Because my friends, remember this, the Christian faces three enemies. Number one is your flesh. It is in Galatians 5:17. The sinful nature wants to do evil and the spirit wants to do what is right. They don't go together. They're opposite to one another. Who, you know, these two forces are fighting each other, so you are not free to carry out your good intention. The flesh, your inner self, that is one enemy you have at the moment. Number two is the world. 1 John 2:15. It's not the people, okay? I want to clarify, we are not enemies of the people, but the system of the world. It says there, do not love the world, nor the things it offers. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. And lastly, the third enemy is the devil himself. 1 Peter 5:8, stay alert, watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And this, my friends, are the enemies we encounter daily. Our flesh, the world, the system of the world, and the devil himself. That is the main enemies that we encounter as Christians, okay? So let's go to the second point. Then the Lord turned them Judges chapter 4. Then the Israelites did an evil thing again in the Lord, and the Lord turned them over to the hands of the Canaanite king. What is my point here? God in His mercy will not let us go, but rather will discipline us until we come to our senses. It was God who sold them or turned them over in the hand of Jabin, king of Canaanite. Despite Israel forsaking and forgetting God, He did not destroy them, but He loved them so much that He would not let them go on their way. It was actually for their good that they were harshly oppressed, because in verse 3, Israel cried out to the Lord. You know, my mom shared to me that my dad usually says that, because in the Philippines, we experience a lot of flooding, you know? And my dad said, Isaiah 26:9 says, "For only when you come to judge the earth will people learn what is right," you know? When disaster strikes us and we cry out, "Lord, save us, Lord, help us," and then after God helps us, we usually forget God. Period. That is the nature of the people. And you know, my mom is actually my news reporter. And she watched a video of two preachers in England who compiled a recent destruction disasters that are happening in the world. And this is what happened in the couple of weeks ago. There were rat infestation in Australia. I don't know if you heard about it. There was volcanic eruption in Congo. There were earthquakes in Bangladesh. In Japan yesterday, there's another earthquake. There were dark clouds and skies in USA and Canada. There were torrential rains in China. All of these weeks were just 2 to 3 weeks ago. And there was a tornado in the Philippines and heavy rains as well in Leyte. This week, one of the volcanoes of the Philippines erupted like we saw it on the sky already. You know, there's so many things that are happening in the world at the moment. In the political area, if you know, Prime Minister Netanyahu is on the right side. He has been ousted, and a coalition of left-wing Arabs and right-wing parties are united just to take him out of office. And in the time of crisis versus extreme terrorists, they are taking out a man who has been used to make strategic decisions to defend the nation. Yeah. They tried to put him down, and he's ousted now in Israel. He's a very good prime minister. He defended Israel for a very long time. Now Prime Minister Bennett is the leader of the nation. A lot of things are happening in the world that we don't know. And of course, we still are facing with COVID-19 coronavirus pandemic. And there's another variant in India, in Vietnam. You know, all of these things, so many things that are happening in the world right now. But you know what? God's hand is over all. Amen? Can we say it together? God's hand is over all. The disaster we see and experience at the moment are God's way of getting our attention to call to Him again. If we personally experience any disaster or trials and problems, my friend, do not take it as if God is against you, but take it as a way God is calling your attention to pray and call on His name. When God turned over the Israelites to Canaan king, He did not destroy the Israelite, but it was actually His saving grace for the Israelite. Why? Because when they were oppressed by the Canaanite king, what did the Israelites do? They cried out to the Lord again. And these disasters that are happening all over the world, my prayer is that the people will call upon God again. And if there's anything, trials in your life at the moment, let it be a call in your life again. Maybe God is getting your attention. Pray again. Call on His name again. If you're facing a difficulty right now, maybe the Lord is calling your attention again. Come back, my son. Come back, my daughter. This is not to harm you, but to call you back to Him. I have a personal testimony about this. You know, this is my beautiful family. That's my dad, my mom, and then my brother, eldest brother. I don't know this guy. No, I'm just kidding. This is my husband, Terrence. So this is my eldest brother and my family, Caleb, on the other side. You know, in our family, my parents are very discerning, you know, when God is telling them. One time, my eldest brother, his name is Pastor Nomar, he would sneeze and be sick terribly, you know, like an allergic reaction. And my mom, because she's really a prayerful mom, God prompts my mom, is there anything wrong with Nomar? And then my mom will confront my brother, Nomar, is there anything you did wrong against God? And true enough, it's either he watched something wrong or he did something wrong. And then he would confess and he would repent and, you know, he will come back to the Lord. For my mom, if my mom has a spirit of bitterness or anger or anything, her arthritis flares up, you know. Suddenly, my mom doesn't have arthritis, but suddenly her joints flares up, and then he will ask the Lord, Lord, what is it in my heart? Why am I having this? And my mom will actually repent, you know, and the pain will subside. That's the personal testimony of my mom. Before as well, I have a very, when I was, I think, age of Andrew, I have this headache that no doctor can explain. I went to an MRI, they thought I have a tumor and everything. Every time my dad will do deliverance ministry, I'm just really having headaches, you know. And it lasted for, I think, 2 months, something like that. Doctors cannot diagnose anything. And then until finally they dealt with me, and then I had a sin in my heart, and I really also had to confess. And eventually it was God, you know. It was not my sin. Sorry, it was my mother and father's sin. They did something wrong, you know. And they had to actually confess. Sometimes it's the daughter or the son that is being tested by God. And they have to really repent, you know. It's sometimes God is calling us back to His attention, searching our hearts. Is there anything in your heart that is not pleasing to God? How do we know if the adversity or trial is because of some sin or we need to deal with or something God allows to build up our faith? That is my question. How do we know if that is a sin, you know, or is it just something to build up our faith? The answer is quite simple. Always ask the Lord to search your heart. And you know it. If you need, you think, you act, you said anything that is not right, your motives are not right, confess it right away. And if you need to ask forgiveness with the person concerned, go ahead. Make restitution straight away. Just confess it to the Lord. If you know there's sin in your heart, do it. Confess it to the Lord. But if you know you are right with God, like Job, he was very right with God, but he still went to a lot of adversities. His children were died, his wealth were gone, he had boils and everything, but he was a righteous man. What will we do? Then ask the Lord for grace to believe that this difficult situation will turn out for good and for His glory. So two things, you know, when something wrong is happening to you, search your heart. God, is there anything? I'm walking into sin right now. Take it away, Lord. I'm sorry. But if you know you are not sinning before God, it might be a test of your faith and character. And ask God, Lord, help me to go through this trial at the moment. And God will make your mess to a message. You're testing to a testimony. Amen? He can change that. So this is what happened to the people of Israel. And what did they do? Point three, they cried to the Lord for help. And this is my point. God waits for His children to humbly cry to Him. Question, does God really want His children to suffer, you know, to have a hard time? Does God really want us to have a hard time? Not at all. Isaiah 45:22 says, let all the world look to me for salvation, for I am God, there is no other. God will wait until we are ready, so we can shorten or lengthen our agony. In Judges 4:3, it took 20 years, you know, for Israel to be harshly oppressed before they turned back to God. God is so gentle that He will not force His will on us. He knows what He waits for us to come to our senses and return to Him, like the father of the prodigal son. 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord isn't slow about His promises, as some people think. He is patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent." My friends, I don't have the answers for everything, and I cannot understand everything that God is doing in the world, in our lives, in your life. I don't have the answers for this. When I read what's going on among the nation, the loss of moral values, the callousness of people over sin, the hatred and how it invades the halls of lawmakers, the bias and fake media, and the impact all this are making on individuals, hopelessness, escapism, indifferences, all we can say is that God is patient. He wants people to repent. But this does not mean that there will be no punishment any longer, for God is a holy and just. 2 Peter 2 says, "So you see, the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from their trials, even while keeping the wicked under punishment until the day of final judgment." The Lord is patient to each and every one of us. He is calling us to repent. Every single time. He is not yet done with us, my friends. He is calling you back to Him. He is calling us back to Him. The things that are happening in the world at the moment, God is waiting for His people to come back to Him. This is not for us to go to destruction, but to call to repentance. But there is a time limit. God is holy and just. If you really don't like to go back to the Lord, then that's it. He will not force His will on your life. If you don't like it, then that's it. But God is giving us time. While we breathe every single day, what does the Bible says? His faithfulness are new every morning. Great is His faithfulness. So while we have time, come back to the Lord. For as the Lord gives us breath and strength and grace, let us cry to the Lord and allow the Holy Spirit to have His free hand to transform us. Amen. Are we getting some things? So, what happened in the next verse? Then Deborah, the wife of Lapidoth, was a prophet who was judging Israel at that time. So if you can see, the Israelites were oppressed by the Canaanites because of their sin. The Lord turned them over to the Canaanites for their own good. And while they were in the Canaanites, they cried out to the Lord, "Lord, help us, please." And then here comes Deborah. God is able to use anyone who is available for Him. Now, let's go to Deborah. Deborah is a prophetess, and a prophetess is someone who heard from the Lord and spoke of Him or to be His mouthpiece. It is clear that God grants the gift of prophecy not just to men, but to women. Amen? Amen. Few other women who prophesied were Miriam, Huldah, Anna, and Philip's four daughters in the book of Acts. And we can see here that Deborah was also a hard-working woman because she was also judging Israel at that time. Plus, she was a wife of Lapidoth. She has a lot of roles. Amen? Woohoo! Mabuhay! You know, all the women are really like this. They have lots of roles. Lapidoth appears no hand in the government. The Bible says a very little about her husband. But Deborah being a wife is a ministry itself. Do you know that being a wife and a mother, whoever is a wife and a mother here, that is your first ministry. Yes. Amen. Yes. If you're asking God, "Lord, how can you use me?" Look at your husband. Look at your children. They are your first ministry. Yes. Serve them with all your heart. Love them with all your heart. Pray for them with all your heart, you know? And that is Deborah. One of the duties and responsibility of the wife is to respect and submit to their husband, as it is written in Ephesians 5:33. With the ministry of prophecy, one can be very arrogant, but here we can see that Deborah was submitting to her husband, because it was, if it was not the case, then God will not use Deborah. Her gender was no issue, and the fact that she was married was never a problem at all. What did Deborah do? Let's go to verse 5. Deborah would sit under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill of Ephraim, and the Israelites will go to her for judgment. So Deborah's job was to sit in the palm of Deborah in near Bethel and Ramah, and the Israelites will go to her for judgment, okay? As a deliverer, that is her job. Well, what does it tell us? In Psalm 92:12 says, the godly will flourish like palm trees and grow stronger like the cedars of Lebanon. Deborah was not an ordinary person, because under the harsh rulership of Jabin, she remained flourishing like a palm tree. You know, she was beautiful even in oppression. She was wise even in oppression. She was sitting, giving right direction even in full oppression of the Canaanites. In struggle, she was still strong. And in Psalm, let's go on. In Psalm 92:12-15 says, but the godly will flourish like palm trees and grow strong in the cedars of Lebanon, for they are transplanted to the Lord's house. They flourish in the courts of our God. Even in old age, they will produce fruit. They will remain vital and green. They will declare, the Lord is just, he is my rock, and there is no evil in him. Deborah had her own palm tree, telling us how essential it is to sit and continue to remain in the Lord, in his courts, listening to him, learning from him, knowing him, worshiping him, obeying him, so that even in old age, they will bear fruit and be fresh and flourishing. The secret to our Christian life, if you want to grow, is to sit under the presence of God. Open your Bible every day and read your Bibles every day. Pray to the Lord every day and you will grow, grow, grow. That's a song in our Sunday school when we were young. That is the basic thing in our, if you want to mature as a Christian, my friends, I cannot do that for you. You will do it by yourself and God will answer you. Sit in the presence of the Lord every day. Don't miss a day without listening to the Lord. As a pastor, this is my cry for our church, that we will grow, not just in numbers. I'm not looking after numbers, but I'm looking for people. The Lord is looking for people who will be mature Christians, that when the time comes, the end is near, you are still gonna proclaim Jesus is Lord. Even in trials and testing and hardship, you are going to remain stable in your Christian life because you're rooted in the Word of God. And that's what our church will be by the grace of God. Amen. And I pray that that is your prayer, like Deborah. An old Christian man said, he's becoming more irritable as he ages. And he was corrected by another and said that the old nature that being fed, the new man becomes more patient as he becomes older. You know, the old man, as a Christian, he becomes irritable. The more he becomes old, he becomes irritable. That should not be the case. As you grow old, you should be more patient, more loving, more caring, more smiling. Who wants to be like that? Yeah, you know, I want to be the old, you know, I just don't have a picture of a woman. But I want to be, when I grow old, I want to be more loving, more patient. My character will be more happier. My character will be more pleasing to people. My character will be pleasing to my husband, you know? That is my prayer as I grow. And Deborah was like that. In her old age, she was still flourishing. Amen? And we have last 2 points. And the against you. Call out 10,000 warriors from the tribe of Naphtali at Mount Nabor, and I will call out Sisera, commander of Jabin's army, along with his chariots. There I will give you victory over him. Barak told her, I will go only if you go with me. You know what? Deborah never believed that God called her alone in the battle. And she realized that God would do much work through Barak. Barak is the warrior, the male warrior. And she said to Barak, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, commands you. Or in other translation, has not the Lord God commanded you? Meaning she was confirming to Barak something that the Lord has spoken already. What is my second to my last point? Has the Lord commanded? God is writing the storyline of our lives. May we not miss it when He calls us. The Lord called Barak and He made it more plain through Deborah. And Barak responded, I will go, but only if you go with me. Can you see that story? God was telling Deborah, Barak, begin to fight Sisera, the army of Jabin. But Barak was so like, he was like, I will only go when you go with me. You know, he was a bit, you know, Barak, this is your calling. Barak, God is saying, do this. But what did Barak say? I will only go when you go with me. Barak demanded that Deborah goes with him in battle, which suggests that Barak's faith relied on Deborah's influence. It showed that Barak trusted Deborah's relationship with God rather than his own relationship with God. And this is what happened. Verse 9, very well, she said, I will go with you, but you will receive no honor on this venture, for the Lord's victory over Sisera will be at the hands of a woman. So Deborah went with Barak to Kadesh. This is what I'm telling you, my dear friends. You have your own storyline. God is writing your own storyline. I cannot do it for you. You have to do it for yourself. Do not miss the thing that God is telling you to do. Don't rely on your pastors. Don't rely on whoever else. Rely on the Lord alone. Barak won the battle versus Kanai, but he did not kill Sisera. Sisera was the crowning victory. If Sisera has been killed by Barak, woohoo! That is a crowning victory. But he was not able to kill Sisera. Another person was able to kill Sisera because he did not do what God wanted him to do. May we not miss the call that God has for us. Tell it to yourself, may I not miss the call God has for me. Cindy Studd said, only one life will soon pass. Only what is done for Christ will last. We only have one life. It will pass. But you know what will not pass? What you have done for Christ. That will last forever. And of course, if you read further, Barak led the Israelites to attack Jabin's army. The enemy panicked. Sisera was captured by a woman, not Deborah, but Jael. And the prophecy of Deborah happened that the victory, they received the victory, but Barak did not receive the crowning victory by killing Sisera. God has a storyline for Barak, but he failed to receive the very crown of that victory. And it's your assignment to read on the next things that happened on that verse. But let's go to the last point, which is in verse 23 to 24. So on the day Israelites saw God defeat Jabin, the Canaanite king, and from that time on, Israelites became stronger and stronger against King Jabin until they finally destroyed him. There were two leaders, Deborah and Barak. They led the army of Israelites, and they become stronger and stronger until they take over Jabin's army. When we take our stand with God against the enemy, He gives us grace to overcome and to mature us as a person and as a church. Because as Christians, we will always face our battles. Always. Ephesians 6:12, we are not fighting against flesh and blood, but the evil rulers, unseen world. The three things, you know, that I've said a while ago, mighty powers in dark world, evil forces, those are the things that we cannot see to put us down as a Christian. And Satan will try his best to take you down, your relationship with God, because he is our enemy. In the Israelites, their enemy was Jabin, but today our enemy is really the devil. So that's the reason why we need to become stronger and stronger with the Lord to fight this enemy. My friends, we need the Lord. I cannot say more about this, but we need the Lord. That is why we need to read our Bibles every day. Why? Because we easily become malnourished, spiritually malnourished. That's the reason why Jesus said, give us today our daily bread. That is why the Lord instituted communion, because we easily forget, you know? What does 1 Corinthians say? Do this in remembrance of me. We easily forget about the salvation. That is why we need to meet together, because we easily get discouraged. This is our picture of our prayer meetings and our Bible study. You know, I don't just have a picture of us gathering together. That's the reason why we have to join together as a church, so that we will not be easily discouraged. We can be spiritually malnourished all the time. We can forget the Lord all the time. We can be easily discouraged. That's the reason why we need to read our Bibles. We need to go to church. We need to do communion all the time, so we can grow stronger and stronger and stronger. We are not doing this every Sunday thing out of ritual. No. You are not going to church because your mom said, your dad said, or, you know, because it's just a ritual, or maybe because Pastor Dave will be upset when we're not here. No, we're not doing it. We are doing this because we want to be encouraged every single Sunday. And praising the Lord will encourage our spiritual life. And it is my prayer that as a church, we will grow stronger and stronger until Satan and his cohorts are destroyed, because we are the army of God. My prayer for us as we end, may we be that servant whom the master finds his job being done very well. You know, in the next chapter, verses, Deborah and Barak was really victorious. They were declaring glorious songs. In Judges chapter 5, they began to praise the Lord. Then there was peace in the land for 40 years. Amazing. Amen. When they captured the enemy, there was peace in the land for 40 years. So, as we end, Judges, may we put the vital lessons in our heart. May it be a warning for us Christians, the cycle of the sin of Israel. Do not copy it. Amen? Follow the Lord faithfully. When the Lord answers your prayers, answers your requests, please do not disobey the Lord again, but rather follow Him faithfully. May we be ready when the Lord calls us. Gideon was too weak, but God used him. Samson was too strong that led to his downfall, but God used him in his last part of his life. And Deborah, gender is not an issue with the Lord. If God wants to use you, be ready. Amen. And lastly, may we grow stronger and stronger in the Lord until the very end. Amen. Did we get something in the book of Judges? Three person, but the Lord has done great things, and the Lord has used them for His glory. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.